Stop messing around, stop fooling around, stop delaying, stop procrastinating. Get up, get out, get it done. Everything is possible, nothing is a problem, and anything can be overcome.
I just get my ass up out of bed, I get my shit together, and I get out and I start the fight.
And that will transform you from a mere mortal into a superhuman being.
I've never, ever, ever met anybody who told me that they got rich watching their IRA or their 401k.
Sure.
All right. Happy Groundhog Day, Peter.
Happy Ground. You know, I know people from Punxsutawney, Pennsylvania.
Do you?
I do.
Word. I forgot you're a Pennsylvania guy.
Well, that has nothing to do with it, but I just know people from Punxsutawney.
Right. Yeah. Have you ever been on the day?
Never been. Yeah. And one of my favorite movies ever.
Yeah. I'm doing it tonight. I'm having a bunch
of people over. Good.
Doing it. It's funny because it's like a fun movie, but it's so like all deep.
Bill Murray makes that movie.
So good. Yeah.
And Ned Ryerson, that guy.
Ned Ryerson.
Yeah.
Ned Ryerson.
Cool. All right, we want to get into some reactions. All right, let's do it.
Definitely. I'll react.
Here, this is Tim Ferriss.
All of the seasoned sales guys who were doing far better than I was doing were
probably
making phone calls
doing
between 9 and 5. Yeah.
Those were the office hours. 9 to 5.
And I said, well,
at 5 they checked
I'm
out.
I'm clearly not doing an effective job mimicking them. What if I did the opposite for
48
hours?
He wants to go 9.
It's a very recoverable experiment. Right? If it doesn't work, then I can always go back to what I was doing. Doing the opposite meant making my calls between, let's just say,
6:30, 8:30. Same thing.
And 8:30. And then
you can find someone awake.
5:30 to 7:30. And it was just a hypothesis.
Probably work like a gem.
Maybe I can get a hold of the people I need to get a hold of more effectively when the gatekeepers aren't there.
Right.
And that's exactly what happened.
I love the way you think.
I started booking more meetings.
Yeah, you have to think outside the box. You have to be different. You have to have a point of difference. You have to push the envelope and do new things.
What if I did the opposite for 48 hours?
Man, people are so defensive from 9 to 5. They're getting calls. They're getting emails. They're being sold. They've got people yelling at them. They've got customers that have needs. Like the last thing they want most of the time is like another person calling them with a sales proposition. So for him to say, he's making calls from 6:30 to 8:30, I don't know who he's finding awake. Maybe he's getting them on the treadmill at the gym. I would be not receptive to a call then. But from 5 to 8 o'clock or whatever he said, 7:30 at night after the 9 to 5 day, you catch people on the way home. You catch people when they're on their cell phone, more likely to pick up. Absolutely. Man, I've been known to track people down at their house. Any good business person, any good salesperson knows how to get access when they need access to you. I've been in my home and brokers have knocked on my door. One particular broker knocked on my door.
Yeah.
You know, like, hey, you don't know me. My name's Bob and I'm the new guy in this area. I'd love to do business with you. I was like, man, came to my house. How did you get that address?
Right.
Because I don't make that
public.
For anybody out there in sales and business, no matter what you're in, if you're trying to meet people socially, get a date at a bar, right? You go to a bar or a gym, how cliche is it? Everyone's always closed off. They're like, they just want to work. They just want to hang out with their friends. They've got lots of easy things to say to you to reject you. But it's when you catch them outside of those environments, that's your opportunity. But you have to create those opportunities for yourself. You have to put yourself in those positions. This guy put himself in the position of just calling people from 5 to 8 o'clock at night. So that's his point of difference. Use that example, translate it to anything and everything in your life. You know, if you're trying to get better in sports and you go to the group practice, what are you doing outside of the practice to better yourself and gain the skills? You practicing one-on-one with yourself or someone else or just doing whatever training you have to by yourself? I think no matter what it is in life, you have to stand out. You have to have a point of difference. You have to do something that's different than what the wave of the masses do. If you can do something different than what the general populace, the bulk of the people are doing, and you can do it well, you'll get traction and you'll have success. If you got to do what the masses do, and hopefully you don't have to for that long, do it better than they do, and then find your points of difference and your niches to carve out. People don't like to be sold. They'll say to you they don't like to be sold. What happens when you walk into a car dealership? Hello, sir, may I help you? Oh, no, I'm just looking. When you walk into a jewelry store, hello, ma'am, how may I help you? Oh, I'm just looking, right? No one says, oh, I'm really interested in buying something. They say, I'm just looking, because they're trying to say, leave me alone. I mean, salespeople that are any good know how to handle that. They know how to respond to that. And there's a way to do it that's correct, and there's a way to do it that's incorrect. So you have to know all those tricks. But calling people, getting access to them, that's just number one, sales 101. You got to get that down.
100%. All right, we'll usually do the video second, but I'm gonna switch it up and go to the tweet. So this tweet is from Tyler at JumpInRE. So I know this is the reaction room, but this is technically a question. He goes, for those with $1 million net worth or more, what was the biggest sacrifice you made in building your wealth?
So the first thing, Tyler, is that $1 million today, regretfully, is not wealth that was built. I wouldn't even call it wealth. So if you take the $1 million and put it into a relatively risk-adjusted and safe investment to generate income from that $1 million sitting there as principal, you're gonna earn 20 or 30 grand at best, and you'll still have some elements of risk. 20 or 30 grand on $1 million, 2 or 3%, it's just not enough. And that's taxable, by the way, in most cases. You really need, I don't know, Tyler, 10, $20 million to have 200 or 300 or 400 or $600,000 worth of income. That's what I would consider to be wealth that was built, build up the wealth. And with that kind of money, you can survive, live, pay taxes, feed family, and have wealth and enjoy a 1% lifestyle. $1 million today, not enough to call it wealth that's built up, but that's not your question. I just wanted to clarify. $1 million, regretfully, just doesn't do crap anymore. So for myself and others that have built up a wealth of more than $1 million, I'm gonna go out on a limb and say that we all have a common thread in sacrifices that we had to make. So we worked more than we played for a long, long time. We made sacrifices, not little tiny, minute, insignificant sacrifices, but meaningful sacrifices in the short term to have long-term gains. So what does that mean? No happy hours, no Friday night at the bar, no Thursday night, Wednesday night, Tuesday night at the bar. We focused on personal growth and development, a lot of reading, a lot of studying, a lot of time in the early years where there was no money being made at all, where we put in hours, days, and years, really perfecting a craft and generating a skill set that would become very useful in building up wealth later on in life. I didn't have a car for the longest time when I was living in New York City. I went to my buildings in taxis and subways. It was a fortune. I went broke on taxi fares, but that's how I would get around. When I finally got a car, it was a hand-me-down from one of my brothers that had a utility vehicle that he used in his business. The thing was falling apart. It had maybe 5,000 miles left on it, but I needed it so bad. So I took it and I drove that clunker around everywhere I went. And I'd roll up to buildings in this white Subaru with like no muffler and the bumpers hanging off and everything. It was a piece of crap. But I didn't enjoy a nice car. I needed a utility vehicle. I didn't enjoy nice clothes or nice housing. I had utility housing and utility clothing. And by utility, I mean just things that got the job done. They weren't expensive, they weren't fancy. And that's how I lived through my 20s. I started to become successful. I had lots of wins, but you make the sacrifices of not circulating in certain groups in your area. I mean, I was a high achiever and aspired to be a market leader. I couldn't just be around those other people that I was aspiring to be like. I had to earn my way in, and the way I earned my way in was dragging my knuckles and fists along the pavement and getting bloodied up and getting punched in the face. I mean, it's a fight and a battle every day. I quote my friend Cindy, you push the boulder up the hill every day. Some days it stays, some days at the end of the day it rolls back a little bit and you start further back down the hill, and you get up and you do it again the next day and the next day and the next day. And that's what people who want to build wealth are dedicated in doing, and they sacrifice everything for that. The good things that come from building wealth don't come until much later on. You have to earn your way in everything all the time in life. You have to earn what you get. If it comes too quickly, if it comes early in your career, if it comes when you're younger, it's not something that resonates with me. And I find that people that have a modicum of success earlier on that haven't made sacrifices, they lose it and they don't know how to maintain it. Earning money is one thing, building wealth is another. Everybody can earn money. It's very easy to earn money. Building wealth, knowing what to do with the money that you earn to build wealth, a whole other thing Sacrifices is a big part of that. If you're someone who's earning money, but you're not really making sacrifices and getting bloodied up, consider coaching, studying, further education, a lot more intensity in what you do. Like, are you an expert? Challenge yourself. I mean, you're only in competition with yourself. So if you feel good about it, then that's great. I guess you've won in a way, but the sacrifices are a big part of it.
All right, well, and last reaction.
Oh man, George, look at this. So it's John Mayer, Robbie McIntosh on guitar. Robbie's one of my top three guitar players ever. JJ Johnson on drums. This was a great band for Mayer. And Mayer's playing the Fender Custom Shop Jimi Hendrix tribute Strat. Really cool guitar. I love Mayer. I've seen him in concert a bunch of times. A total professional. His sound is great. It's really hard to get good sound on these indoor stadiums with a big band and a rock format. He gets great sound, so his sound crew is really good. His musicians are top notch. And I love Mayer. He's a guitar player. He plays cool guitars. He always has great girlfriends. I don't know. Right? That's why you get into playing rock guitar, I guess.
Yeah. He definitely capitalized on that.
This band is great. Yeah. This guy is awesome. He started really young. Like, all the great ones start young, right? No one just waltzes into being a guitar player when they're like 17. So Mayer started young. He was like a prodigy, really, really young, and really worked hard. I mean, he's multi-disciplined. He has a lot of different styles in his quiver. I love this guy. This is a great example of sacrificing to become successful later. We were just talking about that. I mean, this guy got beaten up in his entire life until he was, you know, 20 whatever years old, when he finally had a breakout and he had commercial success. But he was just nose to the grindstone the whole time. Guitar, music. And he's not just a guitar player, he's a musician. So he's got excellent knowledge and chops with like music theory and harmony. Man, here's the harmonies with Robbie McIntosh right now. Man, I love Robbie McIntosh. Robbie McIntosh was in the Pretenders for a long time. One of my favorite guitar bands. I love Chrissy Hynde. And Robbie was the guitar player, one of the guitar players in the Pretenders. And he's awesome. And he's so musical. And he's really well staged here with John Mayer. He's played with Paul McCartney. He's played with everybody. Rob, he's a UK guy, and he's played with everybody. He's amazing. Thanks for putting this up. You know I love anything musical with guitars and guitar. Like, you're hitting my soft spot, so thank you. I appreciate you doing that. You speak my language.
Yeah, this is a good tune. And
so for the sales guys, sorry to cut you off.
No, you're
fine. We're talking about sales guys, how to break through and get access to people. So for all the people out there trying to sell me, call me after hours and talk to me about guitars and music, and then we'll segue into your pitch.
No, 100%.
But you're getting to me right here. I mean, I'll just talk to you about anything. We can lead with this.
Cool. All right. Well, head over to the table.
Let's go to the table.
Sounds great.
Thanks.
Cool. All right. Welcome to the table, Peter. How
you
doing?
George, I'm good, man. You look great this week.
Thank you.
Your
so
colors
much.
Are well matched. You blend. Nothing's jumping out. We're in the middle of winter right now, and you're
That's
not
true.
Wearing like bright pink or bright yellow, which I don't know why you do that, but. Yeah.
Standing out, man. Trying
but
to
look,
stand out.
You're the younger generation I'm trying to be more like, so I should stop criticizing and just probably dress like you.
Well, I should say that I'm not necessarily representative of my generation in that way, so I would be careful about what
you're not.
I mean, maybe I am.
Do you index towards a different generation for some reason?
Well, I wouldn't want to use me as a fashion icon. I think that's all I'm saying.
Not the day that you wore the bright pink and yellow and blue and brown. That wasn't my favorite, although I appreciate that it's emblematic of what people that wear man buns do.
True.
Excellent man
true.
Bun video on you, by the way. That was great.
I appreciate it.
Can we put up you with a man bun again right now?
Totally.
I want people to get
a
profile shot and another experience with your man bun.
And you can trust me because I've got a man bun. Yeah, we can get plenty of man bun.
Thank you.
I take that. So I wanted to start talking today with money makes babies smarter. That's what I wrote on my notes.
Yeah.
You had actually heard about this study already that, like, or I'm going to put
study. Let's air quote study.
That the proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences compared brainwave activity in infants and households receiving
whatever.
Yeah,
dude.
Less money. Yeah. So
this was clearly a PR piece meant to generate a response from the public in support of some political agenda. So what they were saying was money makes babies likely to be more smart. And look, I actually agree with it in terms of the statement that they're making. Like, if you have money and you have babies, you can provide more for your babies, better education, better food, nutrition, better, like all that stuff. Housing is cleaner, safer. I mean, no one's arguing that. But what I argue is their assertion that they did a study and they said, well, we did a study and it was found that money makes babies smarter. And it's just such a stupid way to say it. Because if you overlap the timing of this article with what was happening politically with the Biden administration, you know, they were trying to push through some financial aid,
the child tax credit,
saying that access to this money will make your babies healthier and smarter and all of that. And again, that statement's true. They did a study saying money makes babies smarter. I don't know what the study was. How do you study that? You can't prove that unless you have like many, many generations of babies that you like feed money to versus a group over here on this side of them that you don't feed money to and just sort of see how it all works out after decades and decades and decades. So I don't know what kind of bullshit study this was. It clearly wasn't a study, but there was an article that came out saying that a study was done because people like to read articles and say, oh yeah, see, right there, the article says money makes babies smarter, so therefore it must. I mean, unfortunately, that's the society that we are, where we read something in the media and we think, oh, it must be true. But remember, everything in the media is there for a reason. Media has an agenda. Newspapers, television, radio, all broadcasts of all kinds, there's an agenda. Ownership of those channels have an agenda. They've got their own beliefs. The people conducting interviews and putting out the content that we're listening to on a daily basis, they have their own personal beliefs. Everything and everybody has an agenda, so just be careful how you consume your media because of that. What were you saying before?
I was just going to say, I think the key component of that is that everyone, like that, I think we sometimes think, oh, this group or that group is doing this just out of the goodness of their heart, and they just want you to have pure information. And while there are certainly people that are, you know, more well-intentioned than others, all media everywhere is trying to do something.
There's an agenda.
And agenda doesn't have to be negative, but it just means that there's an intention.
There's an agenda.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I think that money makes babies smarter, makes them healthier. I mean, not by itself. If you put like a baby next to like a stack of hundreds, it's not like all of a sudden the baby's smarter. But what they're attempting to say, I think they failed at saying it, was that if you spend money wisely on certain resources and programs and nutrition and food and education, babies that have access to those things will have a greater likelihood of becoming smarter and having a more enriched and intellect and life, perhaps, maybe better health compared to those who don't have access to that money. But it was a weird article when it came out. I think it was sort of like a regram recently. And, you know, look, every time any president or their administration is trying to push an agenda, you'll see, if you follow the media, you'll see that there's support articles that sort of magically pop up in praise of or in disagreement of whatever the talking point of the day is. I tell you what, George, yeah. I know a lot of babies that were born into money and they are not smart at all. So that's the proof right there. I think we can all agree we know people that were born into money and were babies and were in like a wealthy environment.
Yeah.
Idiots, right? Yeah, I know a lot of people like that.
Yeah, a lot more to do with the circumstances rather than the money itself.
Like everything, it's not having the money that makes you smart or great or successful. It's what you do with it.
Yep.
So I think for the parents out there, if you spend your money on your baby's health and nutrition and learning, then perhaps you have a better off baby. But man, if you don't, you have just an idiot baby. Yeah. Less idiot babies, please. No more of them.
Better off baby. That sounds like an album in the making. Urban office occupancy is up, but so are signing.
In certain places.
In certain places. But so are signing incentives and concessions.
Yeah, they're competing.
Yeah, I was wondering, as a property owner, how do you think about that? How do you underwrite incentives?
You want to compete. You want to get a deal closed. You want to go out to the marketplace, cast a wide net, and get potential tenants to your property and sign leases. Sometimes you have to compete to do that.
Right.
Sometimes in our business, we have to offer a free month of rent or a $300 signing bonus or something like that. What you don't want to do, George, is be in a position where you're saying, we'll give you 2 free months of rent and we'll renovate the kitchen and bathroom. Who knows when that's going to be done, but whenever it's done, it'll be brand new and we'll give you a parking space over here. I mean, when you start doing all of that stuff, you can't fulfill your promise.
Yeah.
So what you want to do is you want to make it quick, easy, affordable, and you want to motivate someone just to make a quick decision. You don't want to have people that are potentially coming in your building say, well, I have to think about it, or I don't know, I'll call you next week, I'm traveling, I don't know. 90% of the customers out there who are looking to sign leases for office or residential, I mean, they do so pretty quickly. They know what they want, they know what they're looking for, they've scoured the marketplace, they can see the listings online, and they go to those three or four or five options, whatever fit their criteria, and they're able to make a decision pretty quickly. So you have to be competitive within a very quick period of time in order to convert someone who's thinking about your product to signing a lease with your product. Yeah. And it goes with residential as well as office and any other kind of real estate. There's options out there for the consumer. How are you going to compete? How are you going to stand out? So you have to know what your competition is offering, if anything, as concessions and incentives. And if they're not offering anything, maybe you offering a half a free month gets the deal done because, hey, it's a half a free month with you versus nothing with the market. It's competitive. There's certain tenants coming back in droves to certain urban office marketplaces, and these office property owners are competing to get them to sign leases. And so you have to give some incentives. In the office market, TI and fit-out, TI stands for tenant improvement, and fit-out is a big part of the mathematics that goes into the negotiation between property owner and tenant, because tenants want to move into a space, they want to have it be built out, or they want to have a vanilla box delivered so that they can easily build out what they need to be building out. There's all sorts of give and take that can happen there. So a big part of incentives and concessions that happens with office landlords is they're horse trading for construction budget, fit out budget, TI budget, flooring. We're going to do certain kind of HVAC. We'll put it in for you or we won't. Like, all of that costs a lot of money. So there's a lot of that that's always on the table and available to speak about for the office tenant. With residential, with multifamily, it's not that much. It's like the apartment's already renovated. I'm not going to promise you anything if it's an apartment under construction and I'm not going to deliver it for 2 or 3 months. You're probably not going to want to sign a lease if I'm going to deliver it in 2 or 3 months. People in the residential apartment marketplace that are looking to move into a new apartment, they want to move in 4 weeks or less. No one's really looking to move in 8 or 12 or 16 weeks. It's a completely different market by then. Whatever I have now is not going to be available in 12 or 16 weeks. It's going to be rented. So I can't hold it for you because I'm losing money for 3 months or 4 months while I'm holding it for you. I wouldn't do that.
Yeah. So I'm excited to hear what you have to say about this. The 4-day work week.
You know what I'm going to say about it.
I do have a
but
feeling.
Ask your question.
No, I do have a feeling. So yes, just several companies are trying it out. You hear about this online and whatnot.
I'd love to know what companies are trying it out. Yeah. But again, go ahead and ask.
Do you see this as just misguided utopian, or do you see any inevitable shift happening in the future? Yeah.
Well, I see both. Okay. I mean, these companies are doing it because a lot of the younger people that are coming into the workforce, the way society is now and the way the culture is, it's like, oh, 4-day work week. But look, I'll tell you what. If you want to be successful, financially successful. We're talking about financially successful. A 4-day work week is not going to do it for you. And you're going to be fine with it. Like, you're going to do whatever it takes to become financially successful. So, I mean, I had 7-day work weeks forever. And I have still lots of 7-day work weeks. It's important to me. It's important to me to achieve, and it's important to me to have wins and success. And you just can't compete. I can't compete unless I have a lot of work time. So it's important to me. It's a big part of how I schedule and how I achieve. And I want to outperform and outdo my competition and my peers. And, you know, I have to have those hours in.
Totally.
If you want to be financially successful, you have to put in whatever it takes. It likely means a 6 or 7 day work week, often for a long period of time. If you don't want to be financially successful and you just want to be exposed to a career in your industry of choice and have a job that pays you an acceptable amount of money, and you're okay paying W-2 taxes on that money, which is the highest tax bracket that there is in our tax system in our country, and you're just happy going to work and whatever your commute is, and hey, 4 days sounds better than 5, right? 5 is not as good as 4, and 4 is better than 6 or 7, because if I'm out on my own, if I'm an entrepreneur, man, I got to work 6 or 7 days. That doesn't sound great. So hey, 4 days sounds good. If that's your thing, God bless. You know, I always say it's whatever you want. If you don't want financial success, huge financial success, then a 4-day work week is probably going to be great for you. And then you can sort of dial in the other details about that life choice, that career choice. And you can fine tune your industry and your company that you're working for and have like a great 4-day work week. And I don't know what you make. I don't know what the companies are. What kind of companies are considering this, George?
I think it's mostly tech companies.
Tech.
But yeah.
It makes sense to me that tech would be considering this. Now, are they making a distinction between working 4 days a week or working in the office 4 days a week and 1 day a week
at home?
You
know, this is a different thing. It's not work from home. It's actually a day off.
So you're working for the company 4 days a week, yep. And you're not working for the company 3 days a week.
Yeah, that's the experiment that's happening.
Yeah. Look, perhaps with artificial intelligence, there's opportunities for the human resources to work less because robots are doing more and computers are doing more. Perhaps that's a part of it. In these tech companies that are exploring a four-day work week. But I don't know. I'd love to know, are these tech companies that are offering four-day work week in their jobs, are they $300,000 or $400,000 a year? Or are they paying $50,000 a year and they're saying you can only work 4 days? I don't know. Productivity is so essential. No matter what your industry, no matter what your business is, productivity is key. Efficiency, productivity. In order to compete, we need more out of the resources that we have. I would love for efficiencies to reduce the work week on our team, George, but I just don't know in the nature of our business. I mean, people need to be available to solve problems in our company all the time. There was recently one person that was with us for several years. She had to leave because she was looking for a remote position that allowed her to work less days a week, but she could work remotely. And I couldn't offer her that situation because we manage assets. Physical assets that have to be dealt with. She had to say goodbye and we gave a hug and kissed each other and it was great and I wish her the best. Yeah. I'm sad that she's gone because she was wonderful, but I can't offer that and I don't know what companies can.
Yeah, I have a feeling this has a lot to do with, it's very industry specific, you know, because it has to do with how—
Construction isn't offering 4 day work weeks. Right. Teaching isn't offering 4 day work weeks.
Yeah, but I think 100%. Yeah, I think that's the thing is that as you said, as technology advances, it's possible that there are particular industries that can take advantage of that and to be that productive. But again, it goes back to, I think, what we've said this before. You know, in the future, either you'll be telling what a machine is going to do or the machine is going to tell you what to do.
Sales isn't a 4 day work week.
Yeah. And so it depends a lot on that. Yeah. No.
Yeah. I don't know. I probably tech is the obvious choice for a 4 day work week.
Right. Yeah.
But only if they're able to get rid of like 50% of their human workforce and replace with computers or robots and then just like throw a bone to the other 50% being like, yeah, work 4 days. I don't give a shit. We just gained like 90% increase in efficiency on the other 50 that we laid off. Yeah. Like that would make sense to me. Yeah. Guys, it's about numbers and math. You have to be profitable. You have to be a successful company that shows profits, that has revenue and controls expenses. So if they're giving a 4 day work week, it's not in a vacuum by itself. I promise you, it's in conjunction with other trade-offs that are happening within the P&L that allow them to afford the 4 day work week. And I promise you that AI, computers, and increased productivity and economics from that stuff is what's green lighting the 4 day work week with these other knuckleheads that are asking for a 4 day work week. And look, sorry I use the word knuckleheads. I'm not. I just don't. Look, I'd love to just make what I make and not have to work for it, right? Yeah. Wouldn't that just be great if we could all just make millions of dollars and not have to spend time or work on doing that? I mean, what the fuck? It's the same thing to me as like, oh, I want to beat Rafa Nadal in tennis. I just don't want to practice. Yeah. You know, I want to beat Tiger Woods at golf. I just don't want to put in the time.
Yeah, there's a distinction between performance and money. That I think like that for you, you're getting a tremendous amount of satisfaction out of performing at the highest level in your industry.
I am.
And there's a lot of people that don't, you know, that they want to get their paycheck.
Of those people, there's a lot of them that say they want to be,
right,
and then they still don't.
Right. And I think that's the distinction that has to be made is, you know, what do you actually want your life to be and what is required to get you there?
Man, so 4 day work week.
Yeah.
What's next? A 3 day work week?
Right. I mean, yeah.
I guess maybe it's all a 0 day. In 300 years, we're going to have a 0 day work week.
I mean,
week?
People talk about that, about the universal income, you know, and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So speaking about, you know, profits, multifamily sales totaled $335.3
billion. That's it?
Last year. Yeah. Up.
Oh, for the year?
Yeah, for the year. Up 128% from 2020. Yeah. I'm sure that's no surprise to
you.
But what was it about multifamily that made you so confident when you got into it? And has anything changed about your perception of it?
A couple of things.
Yeah.
So I knew that multifamily would be a great business for a couple reasons. Number one, every year more babies are born than people die and people need a place to live. Period. Full stop. End of discussion. That's how I knew that it would be a good an asset class to invest in.
Yeah.
That's it.
And
it's still like that now.
I was going to say, yeah.
It's still like that now.
Yeah.
Every year, our birth rates exceed our death rates, and every year we're not able to build enough housing supply to bridge the gap of deficiency that we have, at least in this country,
especially,
and I know
right
that worldwide that exists. It's going to be interesting now with the new technologies that are out there between recycled materials and 3D printing. We talked a little bit about this, but all of that stuff is now sort of fighting its way for marketplace and market share and investor dollars, and they want to be the leading technologies that push the industry forward in the future, and they're going to be able to solve a lot of the housing shortages, but it's going to be a while. It's not like in 3 or 5 years. It's like 20, 50 years. You're going to be seeing new housing getting built very quickly and much more inexpensively than it does now with these new technologies. But until that time comes, more babies are being born than people die, and everyone needs a place to live, and there's not enough housing, man. We have a shortage.
Yeah. No, I got
so I knew for that reason that people were going to rent apartments and apartments would be a good business. As opposed to offices, like I never felt that way about offices. Some people need offices. You know, I never felt that way about commercial strip centers. And I've owned commercial strip centers. They're not great businesses. They never were great businesses. You could only get local and regional tenants. No one has any money for security deposit or build out. You can't get that many credit worthy national A-rated tenants to come in that can like write a check and sign a real lease. You get like a lot of small businesses that come in. They're cash strapped, but they need a place. And it was just never really a great business model to own the strip center that these local and regional businesses would seek to be in. And they're looking for cheap rent and they just need a place to set up shop. I mean, if I'm going to be in a business catering to a retail customer, I'm going to want like the best location and the greatest space and have like the best tenant, all creditworthy A-rated tenants that my bank would like foam at the mouth to lend on my property because I've got the best tenants. That's not really strip centers.
Right.
So apartment buildings are like that. They're very easy to underwrite. It's very easy to know what the income is going to be once you collect your rents and pay expenses. And they have a lot of predictability. And for those reasons, they're very desirable for the banks to lend on. And the banks trip all over themselves to lend on my buildings, non-recourse, at high LTVs. So that means that I don't have to sign personal guarantees and I'll get 70 or 75% loan to value. Guys, what other business is out there where the bank will give you 75% of the money you need to get into business?
Yeah, seriously.
None.
Yeah.
None. There's zero is the answer. And, you know, most businesses you have to put in all cash as equity, either your own equity or from investors' equity. Now you gotta go out and raise money from investors on a risky investment and build out a business, or you have to get some kind of secured loan where you sign personally for it, where there's a guarantee that if things go wrong, and 80% of businesses that are new fail, so it's likely gonna go wrong,
yeah,
that you're on the hook personally for it. In multifamily, I get non-recourse high LTV loans from great lenders. I have relationships with banks. I'm always in the debt markets. And it's a big part of our business, and there's no other business like it. And that's because there's a lot of demand for apartments, and that's because more babies are born than people die, and people need places to live, especially now.
I love it. Cool. Live off the recurring, invest the bumps.
The bumps.
Yeah, the bumps.
Man, you know how to tickle my feathers, George. You know I love this topic.
I do, yeah.
What's your question?
So my question is, with tax season coming up, people have a bump coming up. Can we talk a little bit about that?
Live off the recurring, invest the bumps. Guys, you want to live off of your recurring income. And when you get non-recurring income, I call them bumps, you want to save that money and invest it. So most of us have income that looks like this throughout the year. We earn, and then boop, we get a little one-time check. And then we earn, boop, we get a little one-time check. What are those little boops, those little one-time checks? They can be tax refunds, George. That's what you're talking about, because
yeah,
we're in tax season.
Yeah.
It can be inheritance. It could be a bonus from your job. It can be your company that you work at or own, perhaps, had an incredible quarter and had so much sales that you didn't project, and there's all this money there that perhaps you can now distribute. I tell you what, don't rush out and go on a vacation to Tulum at some yoga retreat. And don't rush out and go buy a Lambo, and don't go and sign a lease for some expensive apartment or house, buy a house that you wouldn't normally have bought except for that one little non-recurring check that you got, that little piece of income. Instead, invest that little piece of income. So you want to live off the recurring income that you earn and invest the bumps of income that happen whenever and if ever they happen, but you have to live off the recurring and invest the bumps at minimum. Now, when I say live off the recurring, live meaning pay your daily and monthly living expenses, save whatever you can, invest whatever you can from that. And then if you get a one-time chunk, then invest that. Don't blow it. Don't spend it. People are always like, oh, I'll pay rent with my tax return, or oh, I'll go on vacation with my tax return. Don't do that, guys. Invest that stuff. We have a very finite amount of money that we get. For some of us, it's a lot. For others, it's a little. For most of us, it's just a little bit of money throughout our lives. Whatever money it is that we get, it's our job to manage that money properly and be able to invest so that when we get older and we're not working and we have family to take care of, that there's money there. So live off the recurring income, invest the non-recurring income. That's a surefire way to get ahead much faster. Don't blow your tax refund money on some vacation or some other stuff, guys. Invest it.
What's that you say is every positive action creates momentum, every negative action creates inertia.
Yes.
Well, it's one of those things that, yeah, if you can invest,
you gotta invest.
Creates that momentum.
We only get so much. We're born and we die, and then in between those two points, we make whatever money it is we make. Some people inherit a little bit of money. Some people don't. Some people never will make any money for whatever reason. Some people will make a lot. Like, whatever your deal is, you have to learn how to craft a life for yourself where you're able to live and have shelter and food and clothing and education and all that stuff that you need, and be able to save and be able to invest. You got to be able to invest. Guys, they don't teach us this in school ever. You have to be able to invest. They teach us how to borrow credit cards, bank loans, banking products. They teach us how to be great consumers, advertising, media outlets, buy this, buy this, buy that, buy this, right? They teach us how to go into student debt, go to college where the government will give you student debt and we'll make it cheap and you can pay it off for 50 years. They teach us how to do all of that. They don't teach us how to invest. Why not? We have to start doing it now. You have to start investing young, early, as quickly as possible. I don't care if you make 20 grand a year, if you make $20 million a year, you have to figure out how to craft your life so that with whatever money it is you have, you're able to live and invest. I promise you, it's the only way to get ahead.
I gotta go sell my Lambo. All right, Zest Quest.
Give me the zest.
What persuades you or has often changed your mind in the past? Facts as an answer is allowed, but not encouraged.
What did you just ask?
So what?
This is an atypical Zest Quest. Usually you're like, what flavor
color,
coffee?
Right,
like,
exactly.
What the fuck is this?
So what often changes your mind? What are the things when you've changed your mind in the past?
Data, facts, thought, analysis, so an articulate presentation.
Articulate presentation is what I'm looking for. Because that's the thing. Is facts as an answer is something that people always go to, but I don't buy it. I don't think that's true. I think...
Articulate presentation.
Okay, yeah. Okay.
If it's easy for me to understand the point you're making, I'm likely to change my mind about whatever it is you're pitching me for.
Yeah.
If it's difficult for me to understand what you're saying, I'm going to be like, let me get out of this.
Now, that makes a lot of sense. Clarity.
Clarity.
Yeah.
Communication skills and presentation skills are so important. This is another thing they don't teach in school. They teach us math and history and science, but they don't teach us how to communicate. Eye contact, body language, how to speak and be articulate, tone of voice, when to pitch up, when to pitch down. Like, all of that stuff means something. Why don't they teach us that? I was involved with my university for many years, and the thing that I'm most proud of that I was able to do and create an impact in was I motivated the school to hire a communications person, someone that had like a business and theater background. I thought it was great. And this person came in and she was able to coach the undergraduate and graduate business students. This was in the business school on how to speak and be articulate. And the pace and eye contact and all of these things that are so crucial, but no one ever teaches us. And I got so sick of watching year after year after year, George. I'd be a judge in the business case competition, and these kids would get up and they'd be like, my name is Bob, and I'm here today to talk to you about the, who's listening to that? Bob, you gotta get the stick out of your ass and you have to learn how to speak to people. You have to put a smile on your face. You have to have eye contact and don't break the eye contact. And you have to talk to me like I'm a normal person, not like I'm a ball of concrete that you're just like talking to with no emotion or passion. I mean, it was crazy. But the school hired this person, and over a little bit of time, we started to see that the kids who were getting this coaching on how to speak and be articulate were having more success in the curriculum than those who weren't having access to that.
Yeah, I didn't mean to shout you down on the facts, because obviously facts are important, but I just feel like that's an answer that a lot of people give, and I don't believe it. I think a lot of people...
You want to know a fact that you would buy into?
I do.
Your man bun is so great. Can we just see it one more time again, please? A little George man bun?
100%.
We'll right here.
Right there.
It's an amazing thing. And the beard, the whole like asymmetrical, not totally like... Yep. Yeah. Well-kept, but like yeah. naturally springing out of his face beard.
Yeah.
So hip. It's Absolutely. So like of today.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm jealous. I wish I could do that stuff.
Style icon. Yeah. That's what I'm going for. All right. I'll head over to Q&A.
Thanks, George.
Thank you, Peter. All right, Peter, ready for a Q&A?
Let's do it, George.
All right.
Give me the name of the person asking the question.
All right, so the name is Josh Goldstein.
Josh Goldstein.
Yeah.
My man, Josh.
There you go, yeah.
I feel like I grew up with Josh Goldstein. I feel like I went to camp with Josh Goldstein. Josh Goldstein.
So Josh has a quick question. It's just, I'm pivoting into a new industry, and I find myself in negotiation quite often as I interview for a new job. What are your best tips for being a rock star at negotiation?
Josh, the first thing, talk about salary and money last. Second thing, ask questions about the industry, the company, the management structure, the ownership structure. Learn about who your counterpart is. Number three, what you don't want to do is go into any interview or meeting where you're just behaving like a Monsieur Moi-je. You know what a Monsieur Moi-je is? A Mr. Me-I, right, in French. So what you don't want to do is say, what's in it for me? How much are you going to pay me? That's not enough for me. When are my vacation days? I need every Christmas and every summer off. No questions asked. I need a corner desk in an office with glass walls so I have a view. Like, if you do that, you're going to get roasted and put right back out on the street on your ass. What you want to do is engage with your counterpart on some information that you might have learned when you researched the company before you went in, about the history, about the future. Ask them about the management structure, about the ownership structure. Ask them how long they've been there, things that they like about it. Listen, it's as much of them interviewing you as it is you interviewing them. Don't forget that, but you have to do it in a classy, elegant way. You can't just be obtuse about it and say, well, it doesn't pay me enough and let's talk about money. Look, you want to talk about money at the end. You have to talk about the compensation, but save that for the end and establish the range. You can say to someone, hey, it's so nice to meet you. I just want to confirm the salary range for the position that you've posted is between this and this. Is that right, ma'am? And let them say to you, yeah, that's right, or no, that's not right. And once they've established the range with you, get off of the compensation and move to these other things that we're talking about. But don't make it about what's in it for me. You have to make it about what you can add, what value you can bring, things that you can do for the company, for the environment, for the culture, for the team. That's what they're going to be interested in hearing about. Everybody comes in and says, what's in it for me? Me, 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 me. And as an employer myself, when I hear that, I'm just done. I'm done with the person. I'm done with the meeting. I'm looking at my watch if I haven't just booted the person out of my office in 4 seconds already. So don't make it about what's in it for me. Make it about what you can bring to the table for your counterpart, for your company, for the person interviewing you. And talk about compensation at the end. And there's ways to do that. You can research that. But you can't be obtuse about it. And you have to be smart about the way you approach these meetings.
Awesome. Cool. All right. Well, thanks so much, Peter. I'll see you next week.
Thanks, George.